It's Smoke Signals, brought to you by IndiansBaseballInsider.com and hosted by Tony Lastoria and Jeff Ellis. They're talking Tribe. Welcome to another edition of Smoke Signals, brought to you by IndiansBaseballInsider.com. I'm Tony Lastoria, your host, along with my co-host Jeff Ellis. We're here talking Tribe again for the second week in a row. We made a record this year, I think, with that, Jeff. We're going to actually kind of delve into a bunch of different topics tonight. Obviously, there was a lot of activity at the deadline. Indians were involved in a lot of stuff, and there's been a lot of stuff happening post-deadline that hasn't been very favorable. So we're going to kind of jump into all these things between the LaCroix miss, the Miller Gent, picking up a guy, Guyer, maybe some of the misses that they didn't get this beyond those guys. Also talk about this Twins team, which looks like the Bronx Bombers out there when they play the Indians, the Salazar injury, the Tigers who are coming up quickly on the Indians' heels. So there's a lot here to talk about tonight. Let's kind of just jump right into this right now. Jeff, I think the best place to start before we get into all this trade stuff over the weekend is what's going on right now with the team. Indians swept Oakland over the weekend and came into this series with the Twins, looking to kind of get the ship ready. They've kind of been treading around that 500 mark up until this series. Since the All-Star break, and they've been a below 500 team since their 14-game win streak. Now, including this second game against the Twins on Tuesday night, they're now 11-14 since that 14-game win streak, and they're 8-8 since the All-Star break. So they've kind of just been kind of hanging around mediocrity here in the second half and pretty much over the last month. We kind of know why that's the case, but what's kind of your thought? What's going on here with this team over the last couple of weeks?
Well, I mean, I think somehow the catching position got worse. Some people like Roger Davis were playing a little over their head, have kind of balanced out a little bit. Chisenhall and Naquin are still playing well, but not quite where they were a month ago. Kipnis is offensively taking a step up, but Napoli is playing better. But most everyone else has kind of slowed a bit. And then the starting pitching is really falling apart. Corey Kluber is improved. Has had arm issues. Trevor Bauer has pretty horrific splits for first and second half for his career. So I had a bad feeling with him heading into July. Carrasco has been incredibly inconsistent. Eventually, bad luck is going to... With Tomlin, because he gives up so many long balls, eventually guys are going to get on base. He's very hittable to begin with. He just doesn't walk people. He's a perfectly fine back-end starter, but with his strikeout rate kind of normalizing and being below where it was the last 2 years, there's not a lot of room for error with him anymore. And, they've just kind of hit this point now where... If four-fifths of the rotation is scuffling a bit, this team is based entirely off its rotation. It just kind of knocks the wind out of them.
Yeah, obviously the driving force for this team in the first half of the season and up through that 14-game winning streak was the starting pitching, and that was what was going to carry this team all year. Now, look, it's a 162-game season. These guys aren't going to be perfect all year. Even the greatest of starters are going to have their 3, 4, 5 bad starts over the course of a year. A team with great pitching is going to go through a stretch like this. The key here now going forward is this team has to find a way to but the starters have to find a way to kind of nip this in the bud and kind of fix what's going wrong here, because with Salazar now down for a couple weeks, the margin of error is a lot less, because you're bringing up now a guy from AAA, Clevinger, who hopefully can answer the call and just give us some solid quality outings. But you're kind of losing a little bit that dominance you have. you know, with one of your main three cogs to that rotation. And now it kind of bumps up Tomlin and Bauer up to a more important role. And, you know, you don't want those, you want those guys, you know, being your fourth and fifth guys where you kind of get away with it a little bit more. But, yeah, I mean, as you said, I mean, just look at a guy like Trevor Bauer. You know, he's made a couple starts here. He's made three starts since the All-Star break. He's 0-1 with a 5.87 ERA, you know. But then in the first half, he was set. I mean, look, I'm just giving general numbers here. I know ERA and wins and losses are not a very good stat to look at, but just generally speaking here, you know, for Joe average fan, just when you look at those numbers, you can tell he's not pitching very strong. He you know, 3.8 ERA, 7.3 record in the first half. You know, his batting average against was a 2.29 in the first half, 2.70 in the second half. I don't have his exact ratios, but his walk K ratio has gotten worse. He's around like a one. I'm just guessing. I'm doing math in my head here. About a 1.5, 1.8 K per walk right now. Where in the first half he was like a 2.7, or even a little bit above that, you know, K per walk. So he's definitely walking a few more guys and striking out. Well, he's actually striking out more. He's actually walking more guys. That's been his problem a little bit here in the second half. I mean, and you can probably go right down the line there. We know Salazar. He's been brutal the last couple outings, and we kind of know a little bit of the reason why, because of the elbow issue. Salazar had an awful outing tonight. You know, Kluber's been the only one that's kind of righted the ship a little bit. So hopefully, and I'm pretty certain here, at some point in the next couple weeks, you know, for the stretch run, the staff's going to kind of hit their stride again, and I think this team will get out another good run. But in the meantime, they just got to find a way to grind out some wins, and it makes it tough when you're kind of burying yourselves early in these games the last couple of days. And hopefully tomorrow, they can go out and get a good quality outing and get an early lead and get a chance to kind of use that bullpen in the late innings. And kind of match up and kind of get a win, and hopefully win on Wednesday and also win on Thursday and split the series with the Twins. Quick question about this game tonight, and I know I don't want to spend too much time on this. We got a lot to talk about, but what about some of the decisions? I thought it was really weird. I listened to Tito after the game too. You know, we used Shaw in the seventh. We used Cody Allen in the eighth. You know, we're kind of preserving an 8-6 lead. And then he comes out in the ninth with Austin Adams. I don't get that. I mean, is there any logic you can pull out of that one?
I mean, I guess he was in his mind thinking, I mean, in the end, it didn't matter. They went very meekly in the end innings. I guess with the only logic I can pull is with that lead and after having used all of those arms last night that he was going to put in Adams and hope to let some, pitchers rest, because it's been back-to-back nights. The starters have been tossed or, had to leave early. So, I mean, because he was the call-up with the Salazar injury, I want to say. So, I think he just went to the fresh arm. You know, I think we all know what Austin Adams is. You know, he's the converted shortstop who throws hard but has absolutely no movement and is a one-and-a-half pitch guy. And, I mean, he's one of those guys that now that Butler's gone, I mean, him and Jesus Aguilar have to be the kind of bubble babies along with Cowgill for the, if they have to add a Yandy, if they decide to add a Yandy Diaz, or if they decide to, and now that they traded Heller, they don't really have another great relief arm down there. So it's, I don't know what they'll do, but I think they went with the fresh arm, and unfortunately it's a guy who just doesn't really have the stuff to be anything more than the last guy in your pen.
Yeah, I listened to Tito after the game, and he said somebody asked him the question, they like, why Adams in the ninth, why not Miller? And he's like, he basically said he didn't want to use Shaw, Allen, and Miller in a loss. And I'm like, that made no sense because you already used Shaw and Allen to kind of hold it and keep it within, striking distance. I mean, you might as well just keep it in striking distance. I mean, it's only two runs. You can score two runs in a you know, snap of a finger, you know, two-run homer or whatever. I mean, there's a lot. I mean, I just almost feel like he kind of just gave up in a sense. Or I don't. I just don't get it. I don't know what he was thinking there. So, I mean,
I think he gave up in the eighth when he didn't pinch hit Guyer for Perez.
I agree. Yeah,
Perez has just been. I mean, I'll still stand that. I mean, we'll get into the Miller deal and the ramifications, but I mean, catcher is just a sinkhole on this team right now, and I don't know what they do, but to leave, you know, basically he quit there. You went out and you get a guy who is just pure and simply a lefty cleaner, lefty killer, and to leave him on your bench in a situation like that. Imagine if he gets a hit, then Santana gets his hit. I mean, all of a sudden that ball game looks very different.
Well, it's almost like he was using a lineup card from Sunday. Like, he didn't know that Guyer and Miller were on the team. I mean, he didn't know to use Guyer in the eighth there to pinch hit. He didn't know to use Miller there in the ninth to not close the game, but keep it there. I mean, I don't know. But whatever. It's 1-162. They can come back the next day and do it. But I just think it was just some weird. I mean, look, he's not perfect. We're all not perfect. You know, and it is what it is. But just some weird management of the bullpen. I mean, why not use Adams then when it was 8-0? Why not just have him? If the idea is that he's going to be on the chopping block anyway for Clevinger, if they're just kind of save some arms, why not just have him come right in right there and just eat an inning or two and save arms then? I don't get it. Why save arms in the ninth inning in a 2-run game and not in the fourth or fifth inning when it's an 8-run game? I the logic there makes no sense, but you know, whatever. You're never going to get the truth out of him, and it is what it is. That's just way to it. Well, we'll just kind of move on from that. But real quick on the Salazar thing, what are your thoughts on that? Does this still kind of concern you, or are you relieved a little bit that the MRI didn't really show much?
I'm not relieved. I just feel like when there's, you know, when we see this and it's just inflammation, then someone comes back and they're still not 100%, and then all of a sudden, it's like, oh, yeah, here's the issue. It's, you know, Tommy John surgery is in his past. He's, we've seen the fact that Tommy, like, for a time there, you know, it was the thought that, oh, everyone comes back fine from it. But what we've now seen is it's become an epidemic that, you know, a lot of guys who haven't end up getting it twice. I mean, there are guys who have had three Tommy Johns. I'm always nervous when it's someone like Salazar who had that injury very young and is having inflammation that can't be explained.
Yeah, and I mean, first of all, I am relieved that it is what it is, but I'm gonna tell you right now, I need to find a way to like track this, because every time like a guy like the Indians kind of like has an injury or whatever and they get a test and he's fine, blah blah blah, and then I feel like it's happened more times than now over the last couple of years, but all of a sudden like a week or two later or a month later, he's injured again. That issue that they tested for, that was he was clear, or it wasn't an issue, all of a sudden it's an issue again, and it results in something else. I mean, the whole Brantley saga this year with the shoulder thing has been just crazy. I mean, I get it is what it is, but there's been other injuries in the past, and there's been several. I just can't think right now off the top of my head, but there's so many instances where a guy was supposedly okay. And, you know, a week or two later or whatever, all of a sudden he's having surgery and he's out for a long time. So, I don't know. I think they kind of caught a break here, but I'm not going to count my chickens yet, because I just think that until I see him back out there and he puts together a good start or two, I'm going to be concerned about him. And boy, what a loss it would be if he is not 100% the rest of the year, if he does have to go on the shelf after he does start throwing it. Because, I mean, that's the thing you got to remember. He's going to be shut down here for a little bit. You got the cortisone shot or whatever, but he's going to be shut down. I mean, how is he going to feel after that, after you know, he starts throwing again in 7-10 days or whatever it is? Is there going to still be pain? And then what do you do? So just because he got a clear MRI doesn't mean they're out of the woods by any means. So but let's just hope that everything is smooth sailing from here on out, because they really can't afford to have him out for any extended period of time. They're going to need him down the stretch, and especially if they make the playoffs, he's going to be somebody that isn't just integral to any kind of postseason run. So, you know, I guess we'll see. I mean, do you have any final thoughts on him before we kind of move on?
I said I'm just mildly concerned. Hopefully it'll end up being nothing. But, you know, time will tell.
Yeah. Last thing real quick before we get into this trade deadline stuff. Tigers, are you concerned about them? Or are they just kind of catching a hot streak right now and they're going to fade? Or this is a team that's going to be with the Indians through the end of the season?
You know, Fulmer has given them such a boost. You know, I'll have to see what happens. You know, they had Zimmerman. I still don't know if they have enough pitching, and that bullpen has been an issue for what feels like a decade for them. You know, I need to stop and see who they've faced during this time. So I don't know if maybe they've ran through an easy part of the schedule or what. But, you know, I think there'll be a team that's in there and contending. But I still think they just don't have enough pitching. They're the only competition. Kansas City's kind of fallen apart. Chicago has fallen apart. If it wasn't for Minnesota dominating the Indians, they might be in line for the number one pick this year in the draft. So it's pretty much Tigers are the team to worry about.
Yeah, the Tigers' win streak is 3 games over Boston, 3 games over Houston, and the first game of the season. So they swept the Red Sox and the Astros last week for 6 wins, 2 quality opponents. And, yeah, they're up against the White Sox right now, and then they got the Mets coming up. So that'd be interesting. I kind of agree with you. I mean, I think that they're going to be in there to the end. I mean, look, at this point, I can't see the Tigers being a team that's going to win 93, 94 games. You know, this is going to be a team that I could see them sneaking around 87, 90 maybe, but I agree that they don't really have the pitching that's going to carry them. You know, they definitely have the offense. I mean, the lineup's just, you know, it's a good lineup. But I just think that defensively and starting pitching-wise, they have some issues there that'll show themselves once they cool down. It's like the Indians. You know, everything kind of went their way for that three-week, two-and-a-half-week stretch there. They won 14 straight, and then they kind of hit the lull again. So I expect the Tigers should go on one of these kind of lulls as well at some point in August and September. But they're going to make it interesting for the Indians. And the Indians aren't doing themselves any favors. They need to find a way to kind of get the ship right and start winning series consistently and, you know, kind of push that lead back up there and get a little more comfortable down the stretch. So, but that's going to set up for an interesting series. I think the Indians have them coming back up here again soon. They have them. No, they don't. They don't have them until September. So, ooh. The Indians will play them in October, or actually September, 4 games in Cleveland. It's the series before their final series of the year. Wow. That's going to be nice. That could be right there for the division. It's going to come down to that series, September 26th to the 29th. Probably, you know, you're looking, maybe the Indians hopefully have a couple game lead, and if they can get a couple wins in it, a win or two in that series, they'll kind of lock it down. So, not to get too far ahead of ourselves, right? Now, as far as the trade deadline goes, man, we came very close to having one hell of a splash. We got the word of LaCroix on Saturday night, and you called it last week on Smoke Signals with the wedding. That there would be a trade, at least in this case, it happened after your wedding. I think the trade didn't get finalized until you're on your way home or whatever. But we thought we had LaCroix until we woke up in the morning. And then we were like, hey, we got Andrew Miller too. We're like, oh, wow, LaCroix and Miller. Wow, what a splash. And all of a sudden, it was kind of like we got rain on our parade and LaCroix decided to nix the deal. So in the end, we just got Miller, and then we also picked up Brandon Guyer, you know, a decent left-handed hit, a decent hitter that kind of specialized against lefties. What's your overall take? I guess first off, let's look at it this way. What's your overall take at the deadline? Do you think the Indians did as much as they could?
I mean, Yeah, it's a hard deadline. I mean, I don't think there's anyone who really came out of it feeling good. They paid the highest cost that any team paid at the deadline with that deal for Miller. I think they paid more for Miller than Texas paid for Jeffries and Lucroy. I think that they, you know, they gave up four legit prospects, two of the top 100 in the game. I mean, two of the top 75 in the game by most count. Legit back end reliever who could probably be called up tomorrow, and another reliever who looks like a solid 6-7 guy. So, I mean, they paid the highest price for a reliever, which is just something I'm never a huge fan of. They went and got Lucroy, which I thought was an absolutely great deal, and then that fell apart. And I mean, there's just there aren't a lot of catchers out there in general. I was trying to come up with ways to get someone that could provide at each side of the, both offensively and defensively, but it's such a limited market. I mean, Guyer is a nice pickup. He does some things very well. He's a solid fourth outfielder who complements Chisenhall and Naquin's inabilities. But, you know, I just think there's a bit of a bad taste for me personally, because catcher was the biggest need by far. They are the worst team in terms of production from the catching position in baseball. Yan Gomes, by the wins created stat, was the worst hitter in all of baseball, not just catcher, but all of baseball. And right now, Perez has been even worse than that. Chris Jimenez is, you know, bounced around how many teams right now, and he's been far and away the best offensive catcher this year, which is kind of a frightening statement. They just have this huge glaring need. It's almost basically their production is like they have a pitcher hitting instead of a catcher there. I mean, it's horrific, and that's still there. And like I said, the high cost of prospects, giving up Frazier and Sheffield and Heller for a reliever was not something I loved, especially when we saw a few guys go for a little bit cheaper. I understand all the reasons for Miller. But when you just get Miller, like, I could deal with it when it was Miller and Lucroy, but when it's Miller alone, it just feels like a lot for middle reliever when this is a team that has other glaring needs.
Yeah, I think that when you look at this team, as far as the deadline goes, I think that there was one clear area that this team needed an upgrade, and that was a catcher. And they thought they had that guy. I mean, Lucroy was a perfect fit. He had the defense they wanted. You know, he throws well, he hits well. I mean, he was a top three he's a top three catcher in all baseball. I mean, really, outside of Buster Posey, you can make an argument he's number two in baseball as far as catchers go, all around, offensively, defensively, everything. So that would have been a huge get, because he would have fit perfectly for what they needed. Now, any other kind of bat there that was out there was going to be a tough fit, because they've already got their first base DH combo with Santana and Napoli. Obviously, second base is locked up with Kitmas and shortstop with Lindor. Third base, yeah, they probably could use an upgrade at third base, but there really wasn't anything out there to get. And then also, they also need a spot to play Ramirez, who's played well this year. So, and they've got some other options potentially there with the, that can kind of help out there, maybe with Urshela or Yandy Diaz in part-time action. But there just wasn't anything there to get third base. And in the outfield, yeah, there's a lot of guys out there they could have probably gotten, but then anybody they would have gotten that was significant would have taken playing time potentially away from a guy like Chisenhall or even Naquin. I mean, Naquin's already been limited as it is. I could see somehow, some way that he would have lost some playing time because they got Bruce or somebody like that. So as much as I would have loved to have those guys, and I would have just said, hey, let's figure it out after you get those guys, it was a tough fit because you also have Michael Brantley that they're thinking about. I mean, he's going to come back here. And if he came back, it's a tough thing to figure out. But then again, you can't bank on him coming back at this point. So, yeah, it all comes back to the whole catcher thing, and that's why they really were – that's why they were ready to make that payment they were going to pay as in terms of four prospects to get him, because he obviously was going to really lock in on a key spot in this team. Really, I thought it was going to finalize this roster with the addition of a bullpen arm or two. So I think moving forward from that, now as far as the LaCroix deal, obviously you kind of wrote your piece on it what they gave up and your thoughts on it. And, I mean, had it gone through, I mean, I guess obviously you love the deal. I mean, I guess, what do you think as far as that whole deal goes by his decision and the missed opportunity there?
Well, I think his camp was trying to spin it a bit. I don't believe for a second that the Indians were not told him, you're not going to be our catcher next year. You know, if he has been a better defensive catcher the past 2 years than Yan Gomes, if their feeling was we got Lou Croy, we're going to let Napoli walk next year, you could have Yan Gomes play first if they're that committed to him. Like, that's a smarter play. And you don't give up four prospects for a guy so he can be, you know, maybe there's a chance they're going to flip him in the offseason. I think it all came down to Cleveland was on his no-trade list. He's on a very team-friendly contract, and he told them, if you don't waive that final year, I'm going to say no. And, I mean, he played hardball. The Indians played hardball, and now he's a Texas Ranger. And I don't blame them. You can't give up the assets they gave up for a rental of Lou Croy. So, I mean, yeah, right-handed bat, could have slotted him at the top of your lineup. Number two catcher on the planet. It would have been nice. You know, Mejia is a bit of a mixed bag just because of the problems that everyone has heard for years with him. And, you know, so getting him back, I just feel like, you know, his days are somewhat numbered in the organization. I think a lot of people kind of grew tired of him. So, I mean, I could see him traded this offseason in some kind of deal. Maybe they keep him. Lord knows he's an extremely talented player. If he didn't have the character issues, you know, he'd probably be one of the top three prospects in the organization. But, I mean, Chang's a guy who's really stepped up and played better this year. It's nice to have Greg Allen back, who's kind of underrated. So we'll see. But
I love Allen.
I think I've compared him to Bourne, the good version of Bourne, with the speed, the defense, and the walk skills. But, you know, it's going to be it's just a shame because it was such an ideal fit for need, and there's so few catchers.
Well, yeah. I mean, and again, that was a move that was potentially going to lock them up, as far as I thought that it was going to make it would have made them the prohibitive World Series favorites, and at least in the AL, if not for the whole thing. I don't get the whole thing. What do you expect the Indians to do? Say, yeah, you're our starting catcher. I mean, no team in the right mind would say anything. I mean, I don't care if Mike Napoli came to the Indians tomorrow and said, hey, am I going to be your first baseman next year? They're not going to tell him either. I mean, no team is – basically, he's asking them to make an offseason decision right now. And, yes, most likely he is the catcher, but they can't give him a guarantee because, yeah, well, what if they trade him? What if they there's very few reasons why he wouldn't be. And the only reason why he would be their catcher next year would be because he's either, one, he's hurt, or two, he's not here because he got traded. I mean, any other reason, he was going to be our catcher next year.
Yeah, it was a silly argument from his camp. Yeah, it made no sense.
Yeah, and then Gomes would have been the backup. I mean, I don't care what anybody says. Gomes would have been the backup, and Gomes would have probably been the one mostly. Now, yeah, LaCroix may have played a couple games at first base. I could see that, or DH, but he would have been the primary catcher. And Gomes would have been one that most likely would have been more on playing some first base or sitting the bench because, he's had two pretty much bad years now in a row here. And I don't think there's any reason that they would ever guarantee him. I mean, I know he gets along with he's good rapport with his pitching staff. He's a good defensive catcher. But so is Jonathan LaCroix. I think LaCroix I don't have the numbers in front of me.
LaCroix is better.
I'm sure he's as good or better defensively.
He was second behind Buster Posey in just about every defensive statistic.
Well, there you go.
Third in defensive run saves over the last 3 years behind Yadier Molina and Buster Posey. He's clearly better.
It's just a stupid argument. And I can't believe that Yan Gomes, whatever. I mean, it is what it is. And what really irks me more is he just went to another another American League team that's going to battle the Indians potentially here in the postseason. And, he was there. The Indians paid the price. The Brewers agreed to it. They were ready to make the trade. And it came down to the stupid no trade clause that screwed him over in this one, which is a very rare thing that happens. I mean, it happens a little bit more than you think, but a mega deal like this is just, especially with the Indians, it's just, it's a real kick in the, you know what, you know, just now.
The leak was so weird. Like, you would think that if they got that far down the road, that this would have been discussed.
That's what I think. That's what the assumption was by everybody. Maybe even the Indians themselves. Maybe they thought that, hey, he's heard the rumors. I'm sure that maybe the Brewers have come up. I mean, I don't know. I don't know what the conversations were like there. But my assumption all along was that he would accept it. But some people did ask me a couple of things. I did say that, well, the only reason why he would turn it down would have been because of the whole issue that, you know, with there being another catcher here. And it's funny how that did come to fruition. I never thought that would really hold anybody back.
You know, I think it just came down to he tried to play hardball and get that option declined. And instead he got traded to a team where he didn't have a choice. But it is, you know, it's interesting with him because offseason it was, I want to play at a small team and I want to play for a contender. And
he's playing for a contender, I guess.
But Arlington's pretty close to Dallas. He didn't get this. I mean, Cleveland would have been. Cleveland fits what he supposedly, quote unquote, was looking for. And if it's one of those things where he wouldn't have even been that far from Milwaukee, where his family, I believe. No, his offseason home's in Louisiana.
Yeah.
I want to say. So,
closer.
Yeah. You know, but it was the fact that they tried to sit there and say that it was because the Yan Gomes thing. The Indians do not give up those prospects with the intention of having Luke Roy not play. That was the silliest argument that clearly came from his camp, and Bob Nightingale was really pushing it. So I guess his camp was really telling him, but while Bob Nightingale was reporting that, just about everyone who's an analyst could sit back and be like, that's
God. Can Bob Nightingale be more of a mouthpiece for an agent? I mean, it's disgusting.
Oh, it was clear. He was just a huge mouthpiece in that whole situation. And you know what? I'm not happy with Roy's choice as an Indians fan, but, you know, that's in his contract. He has that right. Just be straightforward with it. But if he's going to, you know, if he's basically complaining about how bad his contract is, but at the same time, he didn't want to take the fault for playing hardball with the contract. If you're going to play fault, then stand up and say, yeah, I wanted out and they wouldn't let me out. So if you're going to use the veto ability, then you also have to honor the rest of it. And it was unfortunate, and now he's in Texas, which is really unfortunate because they had a massive hole there as well, and now they do not. But so it should be a fun time if they face in the World Series or in the ALCS. And I believe this means that Tony has another droppage. So I guess just to finish the point, it's unfortunate, but it is part of his contract.
I'm here, Jeff. I actually hit my mute button.
Okay.
Yeah, and bottom line is, you know, as I was saying, bottom line here is he's going to play under the same exact contract now in Texas that he would have had to play under in Cleveland. And it just in the end came down to the fact that he was being a whether he got bad advice from his agent or he just didn't fly out want to come here, it's whatever. It's over. I mean, we just got to move on. But it's going to be one of those things that's going to irk me every time I see him in highlights the rest of the year. And then also the potential of his postseason, how the Indians do, if they get there and how they fare, and then also what he does. And how
he's going to be such a villain if they meet up. I mean, it's going to be – if they meet up, he's going to be – the biggest villain in the baseball playoffs for Indians fans.
Yep. Well, I would pay to see that series, and let's hope it gets that far. Let's kind of move on from the Croy. I think that one's been kind of beaten to death on Twitter and everything else. I think everybody's just kind of ready to move on from that one. Now, on a positive note, they went out and got Miller. I know that you already kind of said that they paid a high price. I agree. They paid a very very high price for it. They obviously filled a significant need for this year and the next 2 years. And hopefully he stays healthy and produces, and that's going to fill a huge need that they had in that bullpen going forward. In some respects, this almost could be viewed as not only the pickup for now, but it's almost like they're free agent signing this offseason, where they're signing a reliever for 2 years, $18 million, or whatever the heck he had left on his contract after this year. Now, obviously, they're also paying for four prospects as well. But, you know, this is a piece that's going to kind of hopefully lock down the back of this bullpen, because as we've kind of talked about all throughout the year, this bullpen is just – it's very inconsistent, and there's definitely some holes in it. This is a very huge step to kind of, you know, fixing some of those holes. As far as the price goes, I mean, I'm in total agreement that they vastly overpaid. And I'm just gonna say it like I've said the last couple weeks. I don't care. I think they've got so much depth in the system that they can take a loss of a Sheffield. You know, Frazier hurts. I mean, I'll be the first one to agree with that. That he hurts. But I'm just trying to look at this in a lot of different ways, and I think that again, they have so much depth in the outfield. They, you know, they still have Allen. They still have Zimmer. You know, Brantley's coming back. Naquin's established himself. You know, there's, you know, in a perfect world, if these guys stay healthy, there wasn't really two spots in the outfield in Cleveland in the next 2 or 3 years. There's only one. So only one of Zimmer and Frazier probably were going to be out there in right field. And so I think that with the emergence of Naquin this year, that kind of freed them up where they could trade Zimmer or Frazier. Now, did they trade the right guy as far as in this deal? You know, maybe they could use Frazier as the ammunition in another deal to get a big bat, a catcher or whatever. I mean, there really isn't anybody out there, I don't think, a catcher beyond LaCroix. So, I mean, where were they going to use that ammunition? I think that they decided, hey, we're going to use it. We're going to get this guy here. We believe in this guy. Obviously, that they probably ran the sabermetrics and all their proprietary software through the gamut, and they found out that this guy is legit. He matches up all our needs, both subjectively and objectively. He checks out this, that, and whatever. We're going to go for it. And, you know, I got to applaud him for it. I mean, you know, will it turn out to blow up in their face? Time will only tell. You know, who knows? Justin Sheffield could be Alex White, you know, or he could be I don't know who they traded recently that's gone out to have a good career as far as pitchers go.
I mean, maybe Pomeranz. Jeremy Guthrie. I mean, that's
going to be. Yeah. I mean, yeah. I mean, Pomeranz took a while. He's kind of pitching a little better now. But, you know, Clint Frazier, who knows? Maybe he's Matt LaPorta. Maybe he's Manny Ramirez. I don't know. I mean, whatever. I mean, I guess if it happens, it happens. But hopefully in the meantime, this year, next 2 years, Miller is a big key to the cog to get this team over the hump, potentially win a World Series. I'm willing to pay that price. You know, it goes back to my belief that I think that they've got a ton of depth already. I mean, they have left-handed pitchers right now pouring out of their ears. Now, are they of the quality of Sheffield? No, but they've got guys that are, you know, a step below, and then a couple guys that are maybe two steps below that are pretty good. And they've got a lot of guys there, you know, as far as depth, they're going to be in AAA and AA next year pitching from the left side of the plate. So as much as I hate to see him go, he's still an A-ball. He's still got a couple more rungs to go, and there's always a minefield there. You never know what's going to happen. So,
you just wonder if, like, I guess my thought process was, you know, they did these deals so quickly. If, you know, if the LaCroix deal had come undone, I mean, I think Frazier had to go on the Miller deal, but maybe you still have Sheffield and Mejia's on his way out, or, you know, maybe you keep a Heller and you do Mejia Chen. You know, it's great to have the guys back. I guess my wondering is what would have happened if they hadn't rushed right into the Miller deal, like, you know, how things could have maybe been reordered. Or
I agree,
Ben Heller, I'm one of those guys I just really miss right now in terms of, I mean, Armstrong has looked better of late, and, you know, Crockett has pitched really well. You know, he looks like maybe he can be a solid second lefty. But in terms of relief prospects, all of a sudden, man, it's looking, you know, I like Cam Hill in AA who just got the promotion, but they kind of liquidated their relief prospects.
That is probably the one area that does concern me a little bit. But then again, they've got so many starting pitchers that I think that they can kind of backfill that with guys in rotation. But I think that as far as, you know, you make a good point there with, I was surprised that they didn't wait for the LaCroix thing to become official before they did Miller. I mean, I guess the fact that they did the Miller, maybe it still shows that they were separate trades. They weren't really tied into each other. They didn't wait for the LaCroix to get done. Or maybe they just assumed LaCroix was going to be done. I don't know. But, yeah, I agree. I wonder if they could have traded, flopped out a couple of a prospect or two from the Miller deal. From the LaCroix deal and used them in the Miller deal. I would have been a lot happier getting rid of some of those A-ball guys that are good prospects and keeping a guy like Heller or even Fireyce. I'd rather have some of that relief pitching depth, because I do think that is an area that has it's a little bit unstable now, because they did get rid of two of their top two, three, four guys as far as bullpen arms go, especially with Armstrong kind of iffy this year with his performance numbers are good, but he's still just walking too many people and having trouble command, so can't trust him. I just think that they don't really have that bullpen guy now. Heller was going to be a guy. He would have been up in August. He was going to be a guy that was going to come up here and I think could have potentially impacted this bullpen and helped them out down the stretch. So that's a loss right there as far as the bullpen goes. They do have some depth there, but are they arms that are going to impact? Probably not. They're more sixth, seventh inning arms. One arm is interesting, though, is Garner, Percy Garner. He's come out of nowhere. Last year he was a minor league free agent signing. He bounced around a little bit and had a solid year. They put him in a bullpen this year, and he's lights out. He's up to like 90, I think he's up to 96, 99 miles an hour or something like that. I mean, it's ridiculous. He's throwing heat. He's blowing people away. And maybe he's a wild card there. I mean, even if
that's a good call. I keep forgetting him, and he's more legitimate than I think people know. And he's a guy that I think he probably gets. I think he's 27, so I think he would have to be added to the 40 man. And I think they will look long and hard and consider that. Or is he already?
He'd be a free agent after this year, so yeah, they'd have to add him to 40. I think he's going to be a guy they're going to add here real soon, just to see what they have in him. And look, they can't get any worse than Austin Adams. I mean, look, this is a guy. Maybe they found something. Who knows? I mean, I'll give him credit. I mean, all year I've been saying that he's just kind of like an inventory guy, depth guy, because he's not really he's not their prospect. They signed him as a minor league free agent. And he's just kind of filling in. But sometimes those guys change some minds and they go out there and they perform. But it's not just the performance. It's just it's what they're showing that sometimes
changes. Yeah, the stuff is playing up as well. And that's, if there's one thing that seems that they get pitchers thing. And their stuff plays up, and give credit to the minor league pitching coordinators and coaches.
Yeah. So that's something that might help here. So we'll see. But yeah, I agree with you, though. I mean, there's definitely a little bit of a hole there in the relief pitching department. Hopefully some of these guys – there are a lot of interesting arms in the lower levels, but there's no one to throw 100 miles an hour like Ben Heller did. So that kind of changed things a little bit there. And also have a good breaking ball like he did. So you usually don't get that combination, good movement to go along with that velocity and also a pretty decent off-speed pitch. So we'll see how that goes. So, the Miller is going to help. At some point here, we're going to get some opportunities here to kind of, in some close games, we're going to kind of see where his value really lies. Haven't had a chance yet because his twin series has been awful. But, we're going to definitely get a chance to see his worth. So as long as he stays healthy these next two-plus years, he's going to have a lot of opportunities to lock down some games. We're going to see how they kind of intermix Cody Allen and Andrew Miller there. It was kind of interesting tonight in the eighth inning. I think it was, but he brought in Allen against the lefties, Maurer and the guy before him, where it was, he didn't bring in Miller. It was kind of interesting how it was kind of a bit backwards there. So, maybe Miller is going to be the de facto ninth inning guy, which I hate. I mean, I'd rather just kind of pick one or the other depending on the situation. And then you're fine with the other one in ninth inning. I thought that tonight would have been nice. It worked out in the end, but having Miller go in the eighth and then Allen in the ninth if needed. But whatever. Any final little things on Miller before we kind of wrap things up here with a couple more tidbits?
He's arguably the best reliever in baseball. And I just guess for me, what I want to stress is, like, you know, the attendance hasn't been great these past 2 days, but I feel like this front office, you know, I saw some people still hitting for the making fun of the front office and the cheapness of the Dolans. You know, they went out and traded a lot of prospects and added a lot of salary if all those deals went through, and it's not their fault. You know, I think they had an A-plus deadline. I think it showed that the Dolans are willing to go and spend when it gets them over the top. So, you know, maybe give them a little more credit. I really wish there wasn't this huge negativity between this fan base and the city. But, I mean, this trade deadline should have been everything to prove that that those old jokes and that lazy reporting about them being a team that only looks for diamonds in the rough isn't true. They added the premier bat. It's not their fault that he made his choice. They added the premier reliever. And then they went and added an interesting fourth outfielder. You know, they did what they could do. And I really think people will say, well, they didn't finish it. But I think a lot of credit should be given to the front office for what they did at the deadline.
Yeah, well, I pretty much put a moratorium on that whole Dolan thing a long time ago. Anybody mentioned that, it's like, whatever. I don't even acknowledge anymore. It's just ignorance.
But I mean, the problem is that even mainstream reporters in this city use that because it's easy to get hits, and we've seen it.
Yeah.
You know, it's an easy way to get your content and to connect, and it's just lazy. I mean, there's excellent reporters in this city, don't get me wrong. But we've seen with even mainstream media sinking to that, and it's kind of pathetic at this point. It shows a lack of effort.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Again, I just think it's just pure ignorance. And, you know, look, if you don't understand how it is, then whatever, just don't follow the team. It's the baseball is just a different sport than the other two big sports. It's just the way it's structured, the way it is. The Indians are never going to be a high revenue team. They really weren't before.
And name one free agent that the for all the crap the Dolans get, name one free agent that that Jacobs kept. Every single free agent, I mean, outside of Omar, who was never going to be a big money guy, they lost all their free agents in the 90s as well. This isn't anything new.
Yeah,
it's not like all of a sudden the Dolans rolled in and we started losing free agents. We have never kept free agents. That's just the way baseball works. It's not ideal, but, you know, they traded away Kenny Lofton and then were able to sign him because he had a bad year in Atlanta. But other than that, everyone else was, they traded Lofton before he could leave, Tommy, Manny, Albert, everyone left. So it's just par for the course. I don't understand why, like, in the last decade, all of a sudden it's been magnified. They can't do it, but it's the worst refrain. And I just hope people will take the time and realize.
Yeah. Again, not to rehash all that stuff, but it's easy to have a great roster and all that stuff when you draft Albert, Bell, Manny Ramirez, Jim Tomey, and you make some pretty astute trades for Omar Vizquel and Kenny Lofton. You already have Sandy Alomar from a big trade you made a couple years ago, and you drafted Charles Nagy. So when you have that kind of a core where you have, like, you know, four or five Hall of Famers and borderline Hall of Famers that are in-house without having to give them free agency, it's pretty easy to have a lot of success. So, yeah, you know, I think
all of those were guys who they still lost. And like I said, our big hope with this has to be that this, you know, the last time we traded for a left-handed reliever who could close, who wasn't a rental, and gave up an undersized outfielder, it didn't work out so well. So let's just hope this isn't going to be.
Yeah, that was a completely different trade. I mean, like, you got, like, Rincon was a different pitcher, completely.
He was the closer, pitcher. Though. He was an all-star closer before. I mean, he is a very different pitcher.
But completely different pitcher. I think John Hart, I mean, just obviously a dumb trade. And Giles was already kind of in the major leagues.
Oh, he was definitely in the majors. He had posted an 800 OPS the year before.
So
it's very different.
Pirates kind of fleeced him, so you know they kind of they kind of saw that he was, you know, he had that need, and they kind of got him on it. So good for them, bad for us, I guess, right?
Yep.
Go ahead.
No, I was just agreeing with you.
Okay, yeah, let's kind of touch on Gaia real quick here. Indians traded away I can't say his name. The guy from the AZL Indians kind of came out.
Jalandrin or Jalandre? Yeah.
Salinas. guy came out of nowhere. I didn't know a thing about him before this year started. And then, he throws great.
96?
Yeah. Actually, 97, 98 gets up to. He sits around 95, 96. But, Nathan Lukes, kind of like a fourth outfield kind of guy. Solid. I think he's a solid prospect, but I'm not too worried about it. Guyer, it's an underwhelming move. My biggest problem with it is it's just me. Because after getting LaCroix, you thought you had LaCroix, and you're ending up with this. But I think he'll be a solid addition. I still see issues with this lineup, that there's no protection for Napoli down the road. I think, Jose Ramirez had a great year. He's not a five hitter. I still think he's overachieving with some of the base hits he's getting in clutch situations. At some point, those are going to dry up. It's going to show itself. That's why I was hell-bent on getting a legitimate middle-of-the-order bat here at the deadline. And I would have been fine with getting a Beltran and figuring out later where the hell he plays. Because I just think that there was a big need because they weren't getting LaCroix. LaCroix would have helped in that regard. But I think there's just a big need in that lineup where it's going to show itself here a little bit more over the course of the rest of the season where there's just too much inconsistency and too many guys having big years. Santana is having pretty much a career year. Napoli's having a career year. Lindor is having a great year. It's only his second year. Kipnis is having a career year. Roger Davis was having a pretty good year up until recently. Naquin's just hitting out of his mind. Ramirez is having some.
Yeah, Naquin is completely unsustainable. That's the one I feel bad with. Because I saw somewhere, if you look at players who had 200 plate appearances this year, he has the highest WRC plus in the league. His BABIP, I think, is still over 400. He's a good player, but I just worry that next year, if he turns back into more of an average to above average bat, that people are going to be pitchforked at the ready.
Again, those people can just go away because you have to be. You can't expect that to sustain itself. Some people do; they fall into these traps. If he slides back where he's just an 800 OPS outfielder, that's a damn good player, and I'd be fine.
I'll take that every day of the week.
Exactly, especially if he's patrolling center field, hitting 10, 15 times a year, and playing 25 bases or so, and playing.
If his defense in center field could get back to the above average plus that we thought it would be. That would be a huge thing for this team.
Yeah.
I would almost take a slight downturn in offense if it led to more defense.
Yeah. But as far as Geyer goes, I guess he'll be I guess we'll see. I mean, I think my only issue with him is everybody's calling him this lefty killer. Well, it's kind of a small sample size in my eyes. 65 at bats this year or plate appearances. I think 190 over his career. So,
interesting is the high hit by pitch. He led the league. He leads the league right now in hit by pitch with just those plate appearances. And he hit last year was the league leader in hit by pitch. Yeah. He has a little bit of pop, but his main ability for some whatever reason, it's like his elbow's a magnet. And he gets on base by. I think it's 60 at bats, but he's been hit 23 times, so those wouldn't be part of his at bats. So last year was 24 times. He makes the team better, and Salinas is a wild card, and Lukes is probably a ceiling of a fourth outfielder, so I'm all for upgrading the roster. I still hope we see Diaz at some point, especially now that Uribe is gone, they need someone else who can play a little bit of third in outfield, because what Geyer plus Diaz would give you is two right-handed bats off the bench to kind of equalize the lineup. I like the deal. I wish there was more. I agree. I wish there was more. If they got LaCroix as well as Miller and Geyer was the third piece, you'd just say gravy. That's, it's a nice extra bonus, but yeah.
Yeah, I think Diaz would be in. I think he's the missing piece for the lineup right now, just for the fact that the extra right-handed bat guy is versatile, and I think he can kind of impact in his own way, as far as that goes. Geyer's interesting because he's got 2 years of control beyond this year, so a guy that maybe could be a platoon guy they're looking at in the outfield here for not just this year, but you know, next 2 years. So we'll see how that kind of fits.
And can play all three spots. So that's a nice thing with him. If he's your fourth outfielder, you know, yeah. They didn't really have, especially if like Almonte goes away.
Yeah, he's protected for Nico and Chisholm potentially. So I guess we'll see. So small thing there. And I guess the last thing, was there any misses out there? You think the Indians missed an opportunity to get anything else? Or anybody that you like?
I thought like the closer from Pittsburgh went really cheap. And, you know, Milwaukee, the Lucroy deal, Jeremy Jeffries is an interesting arm who is actually 3.5 years of control. And while I would argue that Brinson plus Ortiz was more than the four prospects we offered, when you added Jeffries and what relievers are going for, that felt like a little less. I just, you know, I wish they would have found a catcher somewhere. That's just the thing. I mean, I brought up Wellington Castillo. It's a lot of swing or miss. He's kind of an average defender, but he was over the last 3 years, I think fourth, as the fourth most home runs among catchers. He was definitely top five, might have even been third most home runs among catchers. That's just the thing. To find, you know, we entered the year thinking we had a wealth of catchers, and then Jan Gomes continued to do what he did last year when he just fell apart. And like I said, I mean, he was horrible. There's no other way around it. And Perez got hurt. And when he's come back, you know, last year he would look like a possibly one of the top 20 catchers in baseball. And this year it's just, I don't know if he's rushed back or what, but it's not been pretty back there.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, I think I agree with a lot of what you said with our misses, where I would have liked to see him get another bullpen arm. I think that's going to be something that's going to show itself still more this rest of this year, is the lack of middle relief. I mean, look at, they got Shaw, Allen, and Miller. What else? I mean, I guess Otero's had a pretty decent year, but I still don't trust the guy. I look at him as the Atchison of 2014 and the Emanship of 2015. I think he's that guy though the last 2 years, where I don't trust him beyond this year, and maybe even this year I don't trust him. I mean, I think he's a solid pitcher, but he's got a little bit more history, I think. He has some success in Oakland, so maybe I sell him short. But now, even if you include him in that mix, that's four relievers. There's nothing else. I mean, there's potential with some of these guys like McAllister. I mean, I guess Stamen is really close coming back. He's up in.
He got promoted to AAA today.
Yeah, so I think he's got like maybe. I wouldn't be surprised if he just makes a couple outings there and he's back in a week or so. I mean, he might help. You know, I kind of liken him to like Bob Howry. When they signed him, he was hurt back in 04. Of Howry came up around July of that year and kind of helped stabilize the bullpen. I could see something like that happening, where maybe he becomes a key piece for the bullpen down the stretch and kind of helps solidify the bullpen next year as well. I don't know what his control is, but I'm pretty sure that he doesn't have 6 years, I don't think, where they can just offer him. He's probably arbitrated. If they, you know, I think he might be arbitration eligible or whatever. I don't have
that part of it, but I can pull it up.
Stamen.
Stamen. I'll pull it up as well while you're talking.
Actually, I just brought it up. he is, I think he's in his final year of arbitration, actually. He is.
Yeah, he'll be a free agent after this year.
Yeah, is he a free agent no matter what?
Yeah, what's 2017. His service time? 5.16. Little over 5 years.
Yeah, he's like 10. He's 20 to 8. Yeah, he's a free agent.
I didn't realize he was an Ohio guy.
Yeah, me neither.
University of Dayton Flyer.
So there you go. So, I mean, so maybe he can help a little bit. You know, I think either maybe they'll get somebody off the waiver wire. Who knows? It's hard. I'm sure somebody will block them. Detroit will block them. It's going to be hard to get anything of quality. You know, so we'll see how that goes. But I really wish they would have gotten another bullpen arm. I'm surprised that in that LaCroix deal that they weren't able to maybe include Jeffress. I mean, if they were willing to trade Jeffress and LaCroix to Texas for, you know, two pretty good prospects, but, I mean, I would love to get Jeffress. I mean, that would have been a great move to me. But then again, maybe they thought that, well, we're getting Miller. We don't want to have three closers. That's just too many pieces. You know, you got too many people you're trying to keep happy or whatever. I don't know.
But I mean, my only thought with Jeffress is, I mean, he hasn't had a problem since 2009, but he is one more bust for marijuana away from being suspended for life. So I don't know if that's, if any of that sticks around with them, if any fear. I mean, he's like I said, he's been clean for 7 years, but he is up to the next one he's done. But like I said, that was 7 years ago. So I'd be at the extreme recesses of my mind if I'm acquiring him.
Yeah. Well, I guess we'll see what happens here, but we'll probably should wrap this puppy up before I lose my connection again. And I guess we'll see how things kind of shake out here over the next week. Maybe they can kind of get the starting pitching back on track, be a little more consistent offensively. They scored 6 runs in 1 inning, and they did nothing else the other 8 innings. So, just a little more consistency across the board, even with the management of the team, a little bit more consistency in that area too. Because gotta get this team kind of going again, because Tigers are high on their heels, and it's gonna make for a very interesting last. We'll be down to about 50 some games now, where they played 104, so they're down to 100, or they're down to 58 games. So, this is now officially a pennant race. So this is what we play for, or what we watch, and follow these teams for these last 2 months, because it really, every game now starts to get a little more important as we get down here. So that said, I guess we'll wrap it up this week, and we'll see how things fall, and hopefully we don't have some negative things to talk about next week as far as bullpen stuff and any more injuries, and it's more that the Indians are going out and rocking and getting this thing rolling. So until then, we'll good luck to the tribe, and we'll see you then.